about how much money Kenya is losing to corruption every year. At least 30% of their annual budget. That's about 800 billion shillings per year. Just name them randomly. Galana Kulalu, National Youth Service, NYS, the maize and sugar scandals, Raraka School land scam, and even the Kimwerer Aror Dam scandal. The list of corruption allegations in the last 2 years alone is quite frankly dizzying.
A long list it is, but worryingly, Kenyans are increasingly less scandalized by scandals. And that's because corruption in Kenya is so deeply entrenched, especially in the civil service, that perpetrators have perfected the art of stealing. The president, whose legacy is sinking with every new scandal, is struggling to hit the brakes on the graft train.
Wewe ndio umekutwa ukifanya lako. Eh, na hawa wasee hawachesi. Tutasoma sisi tu kwa magazeti. Fulani ndio huyo tena ameenda, huyo siku nyingine fulani ndio huyo ameenda. Hakuna pahali ile mtu alikuwa anapiga simu, mambo yamekwenda, ni noma, nisaidie. Hizo simu zilizimwa. Sasa ni wewe ujitetee.
My name is Asha Mwilu, and I'm teaming up with my colleague Waihiga Mwaura to investigate a story tucked away deep in Kenya's grassland heaven. Here, behind the idyllic savanna of the Maasai Mara, lies a tale of greed, abuse of office, and outright fraud.
It's the story of one of Kenya's youngest public universities, struggling with financial pressures even as its highest ranking officials drain the university's coffers dry. But more importantly, it's also the story of four ordinary Kenyans who've risked their lives to reveal the dark secrets of graft and also to tell a never heard before account, an insider's view of the anatomy of corruption in Kenya.
My name is CPA Spencer Sankale Ololchike. I am a senior accountant at Maasai Mara University in Narok, which is a chartered public institution within the Republic. Yes.
Can you tell us why you are speaking to us?
I've come to speak to you because there is information that I have that is crucial regarding the institution that I represent, because I believe it's a public misappropriation of public resources by a state official by virtue of the position that they occupy.
Spencer directly handled the finances of Maasai Mara University, a recently chartered university that rose out of a teacher's college in the dusty and sleepy Narok town. Initially a constituent college of Moi University, and before that, the Narok Teachers Training College, Maasai Mara University is credited for awakening the sleepy economy of Narok town.
We were to be an institution that promotes tourism. That should have been our economic advantage of other institutions. We have, to date, we have a tune of around 13,000 students. All of them, surprisingly, almost 90% are government sponsored.
On December 2nd, 2016, retired President Mwai Kibaki stood at the dais of Maasai Mara University to receive an honorary doctorate in environmental studies. It was the university's fourth graduation ceremony and the most publicized one yet. At the time, Spencer was marking 1.5 years as the acting finance officer.
It took me a period of around 1 year to get to know the financial flow and to have a complete picture of what I'm expected to do. So after that period is when I started seeing things going south.
On the eve of the 2016 graduation ceremony, Spencer remembers receiving instructions to withdraw up to 2.2 million shillings from university accounts. There was no official documentation of what this money was to be used for. Although unprocedural, these ad hoc cash withdrawals had now become the norm.
What caught my eye is when my CEO, my vice chancellor, began saying I need funds to go look for more funds for the university and in form of cash. So I'd advise, why don't we pay them via a check? The issue is, this is a professor. So for her was bado hujajua maneno. Interpreted to mean you've not known how the government works. Yeah? Can you go bring me a check now? Do a check of 300,000. I'm signing it now. You go bring me the cash. And being in an acting position, I'm not signing any check. So what happened? You just carry the check as a clerk would. It is signed. You go to the bank and execute your duties. You bring the cash to the office in liquid cash. It began as a trickle, 200,000, 300,000, half a million. By the time I realized, that was in July 2017, she had signed checks of 9 million and she wanted me to go withdraw in KCB. That's exactly what we did. The deputy vice chancellor in charge of administration, in spite signing the checks, refused the call to pick callbacks from the bank. It's the vice chancellor who was receiving. Every check has a callback. And most probably the person confirming the checks is the vice chancellor. So they did a callback. We got the 9 million in sacks. We took it to her office. Yeah? And that is, the look on her face is something that I've never forgotten in my life, because it's something that almost gives me nightmares.
With every regular check, Spencer was growing jittery and finally decided to confide in one of his trusted colleagues.
He called me sometime in 2017. He was disturbed. He called me, "I want to meet you." So when we met, he was a disturbed man. And he disclosed to me that Stanley have been giving out money in an unprocedural way after requests are made by the boss, who happens to be the VC. So I advised him and told him, "Now what you do in such a scenario, if you refuse to give the money, one, you need to understand that you are in an acting capacity. So acting is normally like on standby. You can be put aside at the will of the appointing authority. So what is the way forward?" I advise him, one, you need to gather evidence.
Hello. The first thing I did was to get a phone conversation recorder. I just downloaded. So every conversation we would have in each day, in the evening, I'll just put them in my laptop, eh? And just clean the phone. So, and I also got a watch that does the recording. The person who would call me most of the time is the VC's driver, Mr. Abdi Noor Hassan. He is the one who would even relay the information, like what is needed to be prepared, the amount, and the venue of the collection, whether it's in the bank, whether it's in the VC's office, or whether it's in a petrol station.
Hello.
How are you?
Fine.
Na uliambia ukuja na check.
Eh.
Unatuwekea sisi pamoja na wewe on one day.
Eh.
Alafu kuna nimeona wamebook lunch on extra.
The tone will be normally just the way he speaks on a normal conversation, but at times it would be a matter of urgency.
Kuna hivi? Usaini wa saizi na profesa sana ukuje naye. Ulale Nairobi. Asubuhi za moja club. Alafu mkijana yako atoe by saa tatu uende nyumbani.
We need to go tomorrow. We are about to leave Narok. We are going to Nairobi. So it would be a matter of why are you not hurrying up to bring the cash withdrawals or the money where we agreed the meeting point.
Sasa, umeambia ukue hapo kesho?
Bwana. Nitanyamaza pesa bwana.
Aje. Kuna kitu ilikuwa nitakana itengenezwe asubuhi. Alafu urudi. Mama hata kama unaweza kuja basi leo on the night tumalize na urudi. Yuko mzuri.
Like most public universities in Kenya, Masai Mara had to adopt a clear flow of leadership and management after receiving its charter in 2013. The university formed its 9-member council, the overall governing body, whose mandate is to provide oversight over all operations. The Vice-Chancellor, Professor Mary Walingo, is a member of the council and serves as the CEO of the university. The professor was the pioneer vice chancellor of the university. She is among a handful of female professors leading public higher learning institutions in Kenya. She was the brain behind the university's botanical gardens, one that is paving way for deeper research on herbal medicine in the country.
vice chancellor from the onset was a very, very, very good administrator. And to us, she was godsend. And the Swahili say that Mgala Mue, lakini akia kempe, I would not take away credit, her credit where it is due or what she deserves.
The management here, with the VC as the chair, involves the deputy vice chancellor, academics and student affairs. We also have a deputy vice chancellor in charge of administration, finance and planning. We have the several HODs, including the finance officer, registrar administration, registrar planning, the head of medical services, and the university legal officer. That basically makes up the management.
Essentially, any instructions to the finance officer ought to be dispatched from the direct supervisor, the deputy vice chancellor in charge of finance, or from the vice chancellor herself. But on most occasions, Spencer would receive his instructions from Mr. Abdi Noor Hassan, the vice chancellor's driver.
I would say that he was just a normal kind of guy with a normal lifestyle. But now, from around 2016, there is now that paradigm shift in terms of lifestyle.
When Noor would call Spencer about money, the language would be coded.
Hata hii ngombe ingine kubwa ilisema, inataka nyazi. Hii ngombe yetu kubwa hii, inasema pia uweke nyazi, inasike nja.
Ngati.
Unaweza pata bandali mbili na nusu?
Ngumu, wacha nione.
The ngombe kubwa actually is the VC. So that is coded language for money. At hiyo bundle mbili, a bundle is 100,000, another bundle 100, and nusu is 50,000. So it's coded language for 250,000. On a rating of 100%, 90% or 95% of the time, he was speaking on behalf of the VC. This is the reason, because you'd make the checks for withdrawals for the amount stated, and you take to the VC, she would not question. She just say, so Noor said, and you'd say it's what you had sent Noor, is the checks that I'm bringing.
Professor Walingo would avoid discussing any financial issues over the phone. This was one rare phone conversation where the vice chancellor requested for money directly.
Yes, bro.
Uko na sangani?
Hapana, yeye ako na roku, professor.
So when will end that work?
SSRM is the one who will return his own way to Nairobi. Yes, we'll send him the money. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, but I need to get a pesa hapo.
Yes.
I need some 50,000.
50? Okay.
Yeah. Hello?
Hello, Prof. I can hear you.
I just get to know, right?
Yes.
The name of Tom, they know where we are.
Okay.
Noor would accompany the university cashiers and collect the money immediately after withdrawal, and Spencer would be there with his trusted hidden camera. On the 18th of April 2017, Noor is captured with one of the cashiers stuffing money into his suit pockets.
On that video, we have the university cashier and the VC's driver, Mr. Noor Abdi Hassan. He was picking money at the Cooperative Bank of Kenya, Narok branch, at the counter, actually the executive section in the bank. That's why he was stuffing the money in his pockets. It was around 400,000. Yes.
What was the money for?
Again, it was not explained to me, so it was just the usual way, like, go sign, we go with you to the bank. Previously, before these huge amounts, he would follow the cashiers to the bank. So it's withdrawn his stuffs in his pocket because it was not a lot of money. But when the money now ballooned, 2 million, 3 million, you cannot stuff it in the pocket, he would do it at the parking and is brought with, in the gurney bags.
On one rare occasion, Spencer would attempt to take money directly to the professor.
There was a time he actually told me that he needed to see some officers, some government officers in Narok, and they needed like 300,000. So what I decided after the withdrawals, I didn't give him. I went to the VC's house, gave her the money, but she insisted take the money to Noor.
Okay. By June 2017, Spencer was admitted in hospital with a bone condition. But even then, the pressure to draft checks and withdraw money persisted. John, whose real identity we are protecting for safety purposes, also worked in the finance office. While Spencer was unwell, he was forced to step in and process the vice chancellor's loot.
I would be concerned because this was not being voted. It was not there in the budget. These were blank checks. There were no supporting documents. No supply had been made. No service had been provided. We're just withdrawing money from the university account without any documentations. So that actually brought a lot of concern to me.
By the time John came into the picture, Masai Mara University cashiers were withdrawing money in the millions. The strategy was to shuffle between the university's 13 bank accounts.
It's a form that we normally fill, the cashiers would fill in the bank, explaining reasons why this money is being withdrawn, the purpose for the withdrawals. So they would cheat that this money was for the university operations, this money was for the maybe payment of teaching practice, payment of cashews and so forth and so forth. So the bank will not be able to raise a red flag. Initially it started with around one check or two checks in a month. We used to withdraw 1 million or half a million. Then it started increasing to 2 million, 2.5, up to 8 million. In a week you would do even 10 million. At a time that actually took 4 million to her and I gave it to her in a bag. In a, what you call it, backpack, whatever. Yeah. So that is the money I gave her. Then also time I gave her the husband 3 million.
To beat the directive by the Central Bank of Kenya requiring explanations for bank transactions above 1 million Kenya shillings, Professor Walingo's team would draft split checks, each worth below 1 million shillings. On the 16th of August 2017, they drafted four checks totaling 3.88 million Kenya shillings from a cooperative bank account. On the 21st of September 2017, four checks worth 2.76 million Kenya shillings from the cooperative bank account. And on the 6th of July 2017, nine checks from Kenya Commercial Bank totaling to 8.29 million Kenya shillings.
What has been withdrawn without attachments, without any documentation, is around 190 million as of now. The fourth quarter, that is between March and that is between April and June this year, over 10 million was withdrawn without any attachments. In the last financial year, that is 2018-2019, over 93 million was withdrawn from the bank accounts without any documentations.
While more than 190 million shillings were being systematically stolen from university coffers, service provision on campus was struggling.
They stopped paying KEMSA. They stopped paying all the suppliers, despite me insisting that they have to provide these services. So the rain started beating us in the year around 2018 up to date. Even as we are speaking, my stores, you know, usually there's a way we forecast. My stores are currently empty, 90% empty. Yeah? The drugstore and the lab reagents, even the pharmacy store.
In August 2017, Spencer was demoted as acting finance officer. CPA Anaclet Biket Okumu took over as the finance officer. Within a short time, Okumu was starting to feel the heat of the Mara cartel.
$1.5 million.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Wakati unapeleganga check kwa nani kwa professor Seno kwa DVC, what support do you normally give to him ndio anakuwa satisfied?
Sometimes unamwambia, sometimes pia unaweka, inakuwa tu ni kama you are making withdrawals za kulipa watu.
Okay, wacha tuone kama tunaweza kupata support ya kufikisha hiyo pesa.
Sawa.
And since then he has done like 154 million since he reported that period. Mind you, I had told you earlier, this one guy, the head, he is defying even the head of state. Like you are told as a finance person, accounting person, go home, a procurement person, head, go home. But he sneaks back and signs check when the executive order is in force. He actually did like 21 million during that period.
Their testimonies read like a movie script. In addition to our analysis of the data, we also shared it with Transparency International Kenya, who in turn tasked their forensic auditors to probe the evidence deeply. TI concluded that the Word document and data provided, that's bank statements, bank reconciliation, and general ledger extracts, signal a problem in the internal controls of the institution. However, the information is not conclusive and a more in-depth analysis of the accounting system, ERP, and cash handling policies versus practice is required. We wanted to know how internal auditors and officers from the Auditor General's office may have missed these inconsistencies in the university's audit reports. Did anyone ever query the consistency of check withdrawals?
After the break, the cover-up, the bribery attempts, and the next step for the Mara heist whistleblowers. Four employees of Masai Mara University are lifting the lid on one of Kenya's best documented corruption schemes.
Electoral money without violence.
The Vice Chancellor of Masai Mara University, Professor Mary Walingo, her finance officer, Anaclet Okumu, and her driver, Abdi Nur Hassan, are accused of embezzling more than 190 million Kenya shillings from university accounts. John, not his real name, works in the finance office at the Masai Mara University. He drafted split checks on behalf and signed by Professor Walingo. We wanted to find out why internal auditors failed to detect 190 million shillings that was withdrawn from university bank accounts without supporting documentation.
We do what you call creative accounting. We'd increase the debtors balances to cover up for the loss in cash. This is a way of adjusting the accounting of a university or an institution to make them balance. Like now for our case where we had lost over 100 million in 2017-2018. So we have the balance sheet, and so we have to increase the debtors because the cash had been lost over 100 million. So, and we have the debtors which is our current asset, so we have to increase the debtors by 100 million so that it fills that gap in the loss of funds.
If it is indeed true that the internal audit accounts were doctored by finance staff at the university, we wondered if officials from the Auditor General's office spotted anything suspicious.
Of course, we have had meetings with them. We have been there in the audit process. But I also don't blame them because some of the documents are not revealed to them. Some of the documents are hidden. So, you know, they use a sample to carry the audit. So if some of the things are hidden, they may not be able to know that something is going on.
John may be right, but our analysis of Spencer's phone recordings and hidden camera footage reveal a more telling narrative. On the 16th of May 2017, Spencer and Noor were on the phone about an ongoing audit process.
Alafu umeongea na audit mzuri.
Nimepatana na huyo team leader, najaribu kuchimba, akaniambia hao walitumwa watu wakuja audit mambo ya revenue. Nikamwambia revenue imetoka wapi? Akaniambia ni vile ilipotiwa na wale watu wanakuja.
Na unaona ni watu tunaweza elewana na hao ama ni watu wakurukaruka?
Mtu mwenye anaongea na Waweru,
yeah,
unamuogopa.
Unafaa ile kitu fanya. na tunaenda juu.
Eh.
Nimebook appointment, tunaenda Thursday kukutana na na auditor general.
Eh.
So wewe pambana na hao uone vile itakuwa.
Haya, sawa.
He was a very good auditor. I can tell you, like, this is among the best auditors I've ever engaged with, because he knew. He knew, actually. He just looked at the bank statements and said something is going on here. Yeah. So they called him, but for him, I think he never recanted even his audit evidence. It was ilikatwa juu. They thought, we've spoken to him, he will tone down. He never toned down. He went did his report at, as it should be done. But these guys, again, they come here. That's when now they started asking for money for auditors, 4 or 5 million. We want to go and see the auditor general. I don't know who auditor general was. But what I can guarantee or can confirm to you is they, we finally got a favorable report. It was around 8 at night. Yeah. So when he came, he said the VC had already paid somebody 300,000 for us to get a favorable audit report. So she needed a refund of the same, so I do the checks. And that's exactly what happened.
We reached out to the outgoing Auditor General on his last day in office about these claims.
Let me tell you, we will know right now if there is my officers, unless they're talking about other officers, if there's an officer on right now who is going to audit, we know right now the time the officer went, what the officer is doing, and we anticipate an output. No issues which have been raised by the ground can be dropped. It may be dropped in the review, but we will, if there is an issue, we can raise them all again.
John is currently facing disciplinary action at work. In this letter, finance officer Mr. Okumu accuses John of failing to hand in quarterly draft audit reports.
They accused me of filing the quarterly reports late.
Why did you do that?
That happened because the books were not balancing. I told the FO that the books of accounts were not balancing because there were some cash which was missing. And instead of asking me the reason why this was happening, he actually wrote to me a letter of a cautionary letter of Lily. That is for financial year 2018-2019.
With all these allegations and the damning evidence, we wanted to hear from Professor Walingo, her driver Noor, and the finance officer, Mr. Okumu. Am I speaking with Professor Mary Walingo?
Yes, sir.
We've received allegations of misappropriation of funds at your institution, and we wanted to give you an opportunity to respond to some of the allegations.
Today, honestly, is not possible because I have these people.
Okay, so you when you say come over there, you mean you're willing to come to Nairobi?
Yes.
Am I speaking to Mr. Biket Okumu?
Yes.
So we're calling you to give you an opportunity to respond to these queries. So we're wondering whether you can grant us a meeting?
It is only fair that, we look at it from the official university communication channel. Because what I'll be doing, I'll be responding on allegations which are touching on the university generally.
Immediately after our phone calls to the three, Spencer was summoned to the Vice Chancellor's office at the university in Narok. The conversation was captured in our secret recording.
Let me show you an example. Nimesema ndio wacha tuone sasa. But I'm to assure you are going nowhere. Wewe ni mkwenu. Rose, give me that check. Those documents. Nimekutoa from nowhere. I was sharpening knife ya kunidunga mimi mwenyewe.
Professor, kitu sijaelewa ni artillery.
Sawa. Taelewa. Sasa nitakuwa nimechukuliwa. Taelewa what it is. Sasa nimeamua, let's fight now. Nimewaita wanakuja. Usifikiri nitaenda wewe utabaki. Utaingia kwanza ndio nifuate.
Okay.
Don't think you'll take me to jail back. Unaingia kwanza na kufuata. Ndio acha nikuashwe. Mugeti nata sema ataingia. You are jokers.
Meanwhile, in Nairobi, another conduit had been sent our way. He alleged that Professor Walingo wanted an informal off-the-record meeting to negotiate.
We rejected Wanyonyi's overtures and made the only offer available on this assignment, a right of reply. Then we got word from the university that Professor Walingo was giving us an appointment for Wednesday morning in Narok.
At the first light of dawn, we were on our way to Narok County. Upon our arrival, Mr. Noor, the visibly influential driver of the Vice Chancellor, received us, accompanied by the university's marketing and legal teams. But then it became apparent that meeting the Vice Chancellor was nowhere in their plans. We were taken on a tour of the university's botanical gardens, the lecture halls, the dorms, anything but that long-awaited sit-down interview with the Vice Chancellor. As the professor's team scrambled to buy more time, something had to give.
We received allegations of misappropriation of funds in this institution, of fraud, and of abuse of office. Misappropriation of funds.
Fraud. And abuse of office.
Abuse of office. If you would like one word, corruption.
I'm sending an invitation to her.
Yeah, we are due to see that.
Yes, the finance officer as well, please talk to her. We also...
So you want to meet the VC?
Yes.
The finance officer?
Yes. And the driver, yes. Receive driver.
Mr. Lord.
Yes.
Kwanza, mimi ni driver kwa university. Sina anything in line of money.
So those who say that you give orders to the finance department?
That is a lie.
That you accompany them to the bank?
If you want a sense in this university,
So you don't go to the bank, you don't... You've never gone to the bank to handle university money?
Sijai enda kwa bank.
Okay.
Tafuta pesa university.
Hile
pesa mimi napatanga, ni kitu inaitwa allowance subsistence.
Before the broadcast of this story, Citizen Television had reached out to Professor Mary Walingo, Mr. Abdi Noor Hassan, CPA Anaclet Bikie Tokumu through direct phone calls, emails, official letters, and a visit to the institution. The trio has chosen silence, threats, delayed tactics, and attempts to compromise us.
I would like to take this chance to thank Citizen TV for highlighting a damning heist at the Maasai Mara University. It helps me in the daunting task that I have been undertaking in attempting to rid the university of deceptive and gluttonous individuals who have been looting from the university coffers for a while now. This continuous financial impropriety and looting not only steals away the future of our children but also impairs development of our institution.
On Friday the 30th of August 2019, Stanley Yaile, Spencer Ololchike, John, and Dr. Anthony Yaile bundled up all the evidence they had been collecting since 2016, from bank statements, photographs of checks, phone conversations, to hidden camera footage.
The four have now formally reported this chain of graft to the Directorate of Criminal Investigations in Nairobi and have officially presented themselves as key witnesses of the Mara heist. Three of these men have applied for witness protection from the state. Spencer, the man who started it all, says he is now ready to face the ending.
It's better to die on your feet than to live on your knees.
The word Narok in Maasai means black or darkness. Narok Town is named after Enkare Narok, a river which weaves its way through that town. Now, the Maasai Mara University was meant to bring a river of opportunity to that previously marginalized county and to be a beacon of hope for young men and women who could now see the promise of higher education brought closer to their doorstep.
But greed took over and brought with it a cloud of darkness in an otherwise growing university. But as they say, every cloud has a silver lining. And in this one, the silver lining is the brave voices who chose truth over silence and courage over fear.
My name is Waihiga Mwaura.
I'm Asha Mwilu.
And this has been a Citizen TV special investigation.